will be water. The second one slide is about the Sustainable Development Goals and from UN, and you see quite well that of course we can contribute to poverty, but and very important to hunger. And we see quite well the relationships between the water and agriculture, about good health and well-being, clean water and sanitation, the priority 6, priority 12, responsible consumption and production, and climate action, climate in relation with water, and life below water, of course, and life also below water for marine water, coastal waters, and fresh waters. And what is the demographic context? You know quite well, it's only one background. It's that we'll have the problem with Africa, which is still increasing in populations to reach 3.5 billion in 2100. And Asiatic countries will be a constant decline of Europe and a little increase of North America. And what are the consequences about the demographic evolution? It's water scarcity, and water use has been growing at more than twice the rate of population's increase in the last century. And in the developing countries, it has increased by, if we look at 2025, it will increase by 50%. And for the developed countries, only of 18 countries, 18%. And water to do what? It's in fact, main use is agriculture in green for the industry and administration here, it's not administration, it's in fact for human consumption. And you see quite well that even when you have, in OECD, you have a 1,500 cubic meter per habitant, but even when you have low, very low input, 100 and 150 in sub-Saharan countries, you will have a large part which is used, the main part is used for agriculture. And if we look at the 4 sites which have been coordinated by UNEP, and you see that the water withdrawal, it's a function of the total availability of water. You see quite well the tendency. You have, of course, the North African countries which are over-exploiting the water resources, but you see quite well that you have in 2025, you have in India and in China, you will have a large problem, but also in Europe, and mainly south of Europe, but also central Europe. And more precisely about the water stress indicator, which is the ratio between withdrawals and all the withdrawals and the supply, you see again that you have this tendency, even in Europe, where we can have in North of Europe, Central Europe, South of Europe, we can have heavily exploited, where we can have 80 to 100% of resources which will be exploited in the future. And the projected water scarcity in 2025, it's in red, it's a physical water scarcity. It means that it's more than 75% of the rivers flows. It's used by the different agriculture, industry, or domestic purposes. And of course, you see these evolutions, you see, from the Arabic countries, Middle East, Indian, to China, and South Africa also. And you have the economic water scarcity in yellow, where in fact you have water, but you have the water resources are abundant, but there is some problems of management of the water, and the water doesn't arrive to the habitants, for example. And what are these consequences? It's about we are in a world where we are unsustainable growth, and with, you see, 7 million people in 43 countries suffer today from water scarcity. By 2025, 1.8 billion people will be in countries with absolute water scarcity. And two-thirds of the world population could be living under water stress conditions. 62% of the world population under water scarcity in 2030. With this existing climate change scenario, almost half the world population will be living in areas of high water stress. And the main problems will be in sub-Saharan Africa with larger stress. But we have also not only the total annual budget or consumption of waters, but we have drought in warmer periods. And you see that for the future, you see that in as well as Spain, France, and also even Belgium, Netherlands. We have real problems during summer about the water scarcity, and it will be also the same in US and even in part of Canada. And in relation with that, if you put the anger map, you see quite well that it's not directly connected, because you need to have demographic and you need to have the number of people which are living there. But you see that the 35% of population undernourished is in Africa in some place. But you see again in India, between roughly 20%. Of the inhabitants are in poverty, and you see that even China doesn't go out completely about this issue. And of course, you have to put this in comparison with the evolution for the next 20 years or 30 years. You see quite well, of course, that in terms of evolution of the conditions for the climate change and in relation to its rain, you will have a large decrease of rain in the, all this around the Mediterranean, around the south of Florida, Texas, and so on. And also going on up to China, you see. And of course, you have to put that in comparisons with the density of populations, you see. And of course, even if you have a very high temperature in Sahara, in sub-Saharan countries, but there is no living habitants there. And the habitants are along the coastline, you see, Algeria, Morocco, Egypt, along the Nile. And you see the dramatic consequences in Middle East, for example, in India, and in China. And what are the consequences? The consequences are very important about human migration, you see. And here you have in pink the borders between highly developed countries where you have a lot of natural resources like water, a lot of agriculture, and poor countries, you see. And you have the one between Europe, North Africa, and Middle East, you see. And of course, you have all the people which are suffering from hunger and for lack of water, which are going and migrating. I think that you have to keep in mind that two-thirds of the migrants are related to food security and water security. And only one third is directly connected to war. And this is the data from UNHCR. And about migrations, you see quite well about around Syria, for example, here. and migration to Europe, to Germany, to France, and to England. And you see also quite well migration from Chinese people to US, and migrations also of Indian peoples to UK, see? And a lot of African countries also, which are going mainly to different countries from Europe. And 14 million refugees in 2014, and you know that it's still going on. Okay, what research can bring? Yeah, it's GPI water, but it's also GPI in association with the scientific communities in GPI climate and also in GPI FACI, about agriculture. First, we're thinking that identification of the resources and water from surface and from underground water, and the sustainable levels of exploitations, you see, to give some advice for the managers. Expected evolution of the resources for modern terms, function of the evolutions of rain, what could be underground waters, what could be, and function of the different uses, what could be the evolutions. Solutions to better manage the water resources, like reservoirs, distributions, leakage, dams, and all the problems of management. Developing safe water systems by improving sanitation techniques in relation with human medicines. Prevention and treatment of water human diseases. Creation of new resources, which is lacking. Recycling, waste treatments, desalinization. For desalinizations, I have a map, for example, about desalination of water in 2012, where you see in green here, in gray, you see the evolution of the tendency of desalinization waters, and you see quite a lot of plants around the Mediterranean countries and in the Middle East. And about climate engineering also. We have to think with GPI climate. When by climate engineering, it's a lot of things. It's about the shadow, role of forest and rain, condensations. What's about the green barrier and the action of green barrier and to stop desertifications, you see. And how we can improve agriculture, less water consuming, and plants adapted to drought, adapted new periodic irrigation system, ICT agrees, agriculture, in relation with, of course, FACI, which is agriculture and climate change, and to save water, you see, or to produce more food. Soil change with increasing of organic matter, and when you are increasing organic matter, you are sequestrating carbons, in relation with the COP21, and also you are doing better management of the water because you have retention of the water. Contribute to limit climate change by promoting use of renewable energy in all the water chain. And all the problems also about prices and economic approach of the water, even in some countries where the water is very scarce, you have no real price of the water, you see. What is the social acceptance of this issue and what are the governance issues about the water? And at the end, developing international cooperation to go faster and promoting world innovations. We are on the way to increase international cooperation. Dominique will speak a lot about this issue because in our last call, we have participation of Brazil, Canada, USA is pending, but China, Vietnam, Taiwan, India, South Africa, Tunisia. And I think it will be very important to have cooperation between EU and Mediterranean countries. EU, it means EU is the GPI water mainly. EU and African countries, Mediterranean countries today, we have the initiative in Rome, the initiative Prima meeting, which is about food security and water around the Mediterranean countries. You have the two Iranets, ARIMNET and IranetMed, which are with the African countries, there is a long-term European and African partnerships with a co-fund about agriculture and water. We can join this initiative, and about the Asiatic countries, we see quite well from the maps that India and China must be very important. They will have major changes, and in relation also with the demography, we need to have a strong cooperation with these countries. It's the reason why I put targeted countries. But you will discuss later, I think, about this issue. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Maurice. If you had any doubt about the importance of water research and the importance of the subject, then I think Maurice's slides there in terms of scarcity, in terms of hunger, in terms of migration and all of the knock-on effects make it very clear that the work that you do as researchers in the water area is extremely important to the future of mankind indeed, not to put it too strongly. So Maurice and Bernardo are taking their leave of us now, so thank you very much for that. We continue with Maria Uccella Torre, who is from the Ministry of Education, University and Research. She manages the office with responsibility for international research, and indeed she's a member of the High-Level Expert Group on Joint Programming. So, Maria.
Hello. Good morning to everybody. I am very happy to be here with you, also because I am on behalf of my head of department, Professor Marco Mancini, who could not be present today, unfortunately, for an institutional duty suddenly arrived. But I am very happy in every case to be here because I have been present since the beginning of this JPI very often as a testimonial of my ministry and my country. I wanted to underline to start that since the beginning, in fact, our ministry is strongly supporting the joint programming. And from 2009, my ministry, step by step, goes inside all the 10 JPIs that we are now living inside our research program. Inside these 10 old JPIs, we are as a coordinator in the JPIs about cultural heritage, and now recently also as co-coordinator for this JPI. We are actively, as you know, participating in joint calls and in every actions promoted in all the joint programming initiatives, with, of course, the support also of several other interested ministries for this, about their specific competence. Now, you know that the JPI Water Challenges for the Changing World, launched in 2011 and adopted its first strategic research innovation agenda in 2013, and after we adopted implementation plan in 2014, now we are inside 20 member state countries, several associated countries, and as well four observers. The Commission, as you know, is a non-voting member, but supported one CSR, Coordination Support Action, and two ERANET co-fund actions, and also a second CSA on the international cooperation is proposed in the 2016 work program, as imagine you know. Thanks. This I wanted to underline, that as you can imagine, thanks to high level of cooperation with the national involved organization, my ministry positively evaluates the envisaged collaboration among the JPIs for better approach to the challenge in the near future. Like, for instance, the ongoing call on sustainable management of water resources in agriculture, forestry, and freshwater aquaculture sector. this jointly promoted between the water and FACE JPIs for international and transnational collaborative research project. It, I agree, I imagine with you, would be useful to consider analog initiatives among the water JPI and other JPIs as climate and urban Europe, of course, for better approach the effects of climate change on water cycle and water resources availability and the importance of developing more efficient water service in the urban context and have, this is important, more resilient cities. Now, if we want to speak beside the coordination, among the joint initiatives, all of us agree that there is a need to coordinate the European level and the regional activities. And so, as you know, my ministry is promoting PRIMA, a partnership for research and innovation in the Mediterranean area. This to contribute to the challenge of sustainable food production and water provision in the region. This initiative involves Europe and non-Europe countries and, like the JPIs, is taking advantage of the cooperation matured along the implementation of ERANET projects, like, for instance, in this case, of course, ERANET MET. The internationalization, coordination, and integration of national initiatives with European and global ones, moreover, is one of the main objectives. This is important that I underline for my country, for my ministry, of the national research program launched just now in the 2 of May. And this national research program involves more than 2.4 billion euro for public investment devoted to scientific research, of course, for the 2015-2020 period. So, it's clear that our national research program organically integrates the programming of Horizon 2020, and it was aligned with the criteria and the tools agreed at European level. But JPIs propose also new forms of cross-border cooperation that go beyond the collaborative projects or mobility actions. So member states engaged in JPIs agree on common research and innovation agenda and on the alignment of national research and innovation programs on a number of common strategic goals, on activities to foster international cooperation and on the implementation of the joint actions. In fact, the Strategic Research Innovation Agenda 2.0 was conceived to guide future water-related research, development, innovation measures in Europe, included, but not only limited to, the water JPI actions from the implementation plan. To this end, it set up out specific research, development, innovation priorities or on areas where research, development, innovation measures are highly recommended. Now I conclude, and I, me too, as the president before, I wish you a very successful, stimulating, and fruitful meeting, and why not, I hope you will enjoy your stay in my city, in Rome. Good morning.
Thank you, Maria. Thank you, Maria. We have one more, of the introductory talks to go. But last but by no means least is Carlo Maria Medaglia. I hope I pronounced that right. He is head of the Technical Secretariat in the Ministry of Environment, Territory and Sea. He's a physicist by profession, and he has worked in many national and international research centres, founded and coordinated scientific laboratories. So, Carlo, I beg your pardon. Maria wants to say one more thing.
I apologize, but the time is went on, and I must leave. I'm sorry.
We understand that. Understand that totally. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, Carlo.
Thanks to everybody, especially thanks to Dr. Erral and Dr. Larkin for organizing here in Rome this fantastic meeting. Probably the most important part of my CV is that I took my PhD on floods. So it's a strange situation. Also, I'm very happy to be here in behalf of my minister, Gianluca Galletti, that is in the south part of Italy, to resolve problem and not to try to understand some part of the future. The talk of Maurice probably clear all the possible vision of the future. I think that this year is very important. It's not only important for the work that with the Ministry Galletti and all the other European and worldwide partner we do in Paris for the COP21 and with the sustainable goal in New York. I think that is important because at international level, the agree that we reach is important not only for the number, but for the method. The method is a method that permit to upgrade policy that can be upgraded in line with the research, in line with the work that all we will do in the research field. And I think this is very important because in Paris we stress a lot the capacity building, the transfer knowledge and the technology that is very important in all the field of environment and especially today in the field of climate and water with the work of the JPI. I think that not a worldwide level, but at European level is a very important period. This year is important for the, as Bernardo speak before, for the flood directive, for the marine strategy, for the water directive. So a lot of stuff are going, and we must work in the research to resolve all the problems that Maurice outlined before. Because it's not a problem of scarcity, it's not a problem of having water in our house, but it's a problem of refugee, it's a problem of a lot of human migration. And this is very important at not only for our research in our lab, but at worldwide level for all the people that can have an improving of their life with our research. In Italy, it's not only a problem of the agree at the European and the worldwide level. In Italy, Gianluca Galletti push a lot on the water problem, and we are doing a lot of work of reorganization of the basin authority in the context of the hydrographic district. And this is very important for the usage of and of water in Italy, and we are working together with all the national research and institutional organization in the Italian climate change adaptation strategy, in which water is a fundamental part. Fundamental part also for not only the goals that Maurice outlined before, but in Italy we have also a lot of problem on hydrological risk. I see a lot of my colleague in university working on this field. I think that before starting the working day and this work, fruitful work of research, I think that is the message of my minister, Gianluca Galletti, is that we will a lot work on support the JPI water and also the together work with the JPI climate. We really want to push on this field, and we want to try to have the research going up and support the decision maker to plan and implement adaptation action. So we really want to stress the work of JPA, and we want to work with you, not only at technical and scientific level with ISPRA, but also at policy level, to try to support as co-chair of the JPI as we much as we can the work of the research that all our can do together. I want to close with the really thanks to not only to the JPI, to Professor De Bernardinis, but also want to thanks Elena Giusta, Giuseppina Monacelli, Alessandra Casali, Annalisa Sambati, and Paola Gianbianco that for ISPRA really work all day to have this this meeting and to have Italy in the center of the discussion. That for us is very important. Thanks and good work.
Thank you, Carlo. Now that concludes the high level, if you like, the introductory bit. Just before, we're now going to begin to focus on the water JPI. Before we do, I'm conscious that there's some latecomers who maybe haven't got a good view of the screen. There are some empty seats in the middle here at the back, and some over there, and indeed some over here as well. So if people who are sitting in the wings feel it a little bit that they haven't got a good view, they are welcome to move. I'm also conscious of the fact that you've been listening to a lot now, so if you want to stand up and stretch and loosen out a little bit, that's perfectly fine too, because you know, you can begin to get a little bit tired if you're sitting in one position and listening to lots of talk. So I won't mind if people stand up and stretch now while we begin to focus on... Well done. Well done, Matt. Thank you very much. Well done. And Prisca as well. Good girl. We're now beginning to focus on the water JPI itself, and later on today we will focus particularly on our strategic research and innovation agenda, and that is the main work of the day. We are going to have roundtables, we're going to be interactive, and you are going to work as well. So you're not just receiving, we're going to pick your brains as the day goes on. But we now have from the European Commission, Panos Balbanis, who is going to talk to us about the position of the water JPI in a global world. And as those of you, I'm sure, who know Panos, know that he's working in DG Research and Innovation, Deputy Director of the Eco Innovation Unit. So Panos, you're very welcome to the podium.
Thank you very much, Patrick. Good morning to everybody. Thanks also for giving also the opportunity, first of all, also to the Commission, also to address this major event of the Water GPI, but also I have also the pleasure also personally also to attend, since I'm also dealing with several also water-related issues since many years in my career in the Commission. But I would like, I think, since it is still a kind of introductory presentation, to also put also this water GPI in the perspectives. And also in this context, I would like more to present you, you know, some kind of drivers to try to explain, you know, what are also the key elements which also drive also our activities. And then also try also to, because I think this is important to try to help you also in preparing also the strategic research agenda, to try also to see also the synergies, the potential, the complementarities with existing other initiatives and frameworks. Before, I will not go to stay more on that, but I think it is important also to highlight, as also Maurice also mentioned, water is becoming increasingly nowadays, you know, an important element, you know, and very important, you know, I would say, challenge and risk at the global level, not only for the environment and the society, but also very, very important for our global economy. And I think this is also an important element. We have also to be more proactive also in putting also water in the center also of the economic developments. I think this is important if we will want also water to have a bigger also influence and decision and use also the knowledge of the water to solve also our problems. As it was mentioned in a recent conference, and somebody said that only if we put also water in the minds of the Minister of Economy, then you can also expect also to see more happening in this area. But I would like here to highlight also, as it also Maurice mentioned, many foresights also exercises shows testimony this fact. And I think this is, I would like just to mention to you some of the a recent also study which came from this European Strategy and Policy Analysis System project that the Commission also supported, which also highlight that the managing the scarcity also of the resources is going also to become, you know, this an important challenge with also in conjunction with the rising energy consumption and the shifting also patterns of consumption. And this is important because despite also the slowdown of global growth population, there is also still a lot of competition also to access to natural resources, in particular on water. And this is also is going also to continue because also the large scale of exploitation of natural resources, in particular also for raw material, is mainly also devoted and linked to very few countries also in the regions. And food and water will be two interrelated things which are going also to be exasperated by the expected also climate changes. The World Bank, for instance, makes some recent projections where they say that by the 2025, more than food will be also affected also by water availability, and this will affect more of 1.4 billion of people in the world. And another also important, which also shows that also water should not be also looked alone, but it should be also seen in connection with different also other issues, like in particular energy and food. I would like also to insist on the energy. You see here the figures about also the energy consumption, the increase of the energy consumption in the next years. And I would like to stress also the strong links between, you know, water and energy production, which is a factor which is not clearly also addressed also if you look at the EU energy policy, you will hardly see any reference also to the water. So this also highlights, of course, that this is an area where there are important elements also for investment. And this is an area where they need also to look more on research and innovation. And this, as I said, is not only for, certainly this is for the citizens, also for the society, but also is also very important also for the market, because if you look also the potential with the developments in the emerging economies, of course, water will be also an important element for the development of these countries. So there also there are a lot of business opportunities. So we have also to give also the opportunity also to the European industry also to continue to be a leader in this global market. Having said this, I would like, of course, to acknowledge that water has been from the early from the beginning of the framework programs receive also proper attention in terms also of funding. And of course this came, of course, as you can see, in various ways. There were different type of priorities and different type of issues, but it was always, I think, the main issues that was also linked also with the wider policies at the European level, and trying also to provide also the knowledge and the base, the scientific basis on which many policies can be built. And there have been several also examples, just to highlight, you know, a particular project, for instance, in the fifth framework program that they looked, for instance, in groundwater quality, and this was a pivotal also project in defining also in the groundwater directive also the approach on the type of thresholds also to be looked at. But little by little also water, I think, in the latest also years, in particular also now in the end of FP7, in particular within Horizon 2020, also water research activities took into in consideration also the, as I said, the economic dimension and importance of water. Just also to highlight, this is a figure that it was also produced at the time that the water GPI was starting and doing also this mapping exercise. So this helped us also to look to our activities, and also this show you already the type, the magnitude of actions. We're now going to do something similar for the first two Horizon calls, because I think it will be important also to compare and to keep also going on with this type of information, which can also hit also the interest of policymakers. Some important elements that I said that I will try also to identify some of the drivers that they help us also in the beginning of Horizon 2020, you know, to structure our activities. And you can see here also different type of activities. You have, let's say, some more policy, general policy initiative, like, for instance, this resource efficiency flagship initiative, which, you know, gave also some policy recommendations, the Eco-Innovation Action Plan, also the European the Innovation Union flagship initiative. But then on top of that, we had also some activities at the European level that they tried also to also support also research and innovation in this area, trying also to either to bring together also national activities, like, for instance, the Joint Programming Initiative, and also some activities like the technology platforms that they try to also more to bring also the private sector, trying also to address also the requirements, the research also priorities that the private sector also had, in order also to improve also the participation and the linkages between these sectors. Let me try also to see how these policy initiatives, in particular the three main initiatives, the Joint Programming Initiative, the European Technology Platform, the Water, the WSSTP, and the European Innovation Partnership, how these activities are working, and how, for instance, we can also try also to see what are the potentials there for synergies, because this is important in defining also our research agenda. So here you can see also the kind of rationale that we have used also in developing Horizon 2020. Since Horizon 2020 was now more embracing the whole innovation cycle, we thought that it was better, instead of trying also to build also complementarities with different projects. For instance, wastewater management can be seen in different ways. Instead of trying, you know, to address, you know, the themes, you know, in complementarity, we thought that it would be better to have a more kind of boundaries, having also the Joint Programming Initiative addressing more the early stage of the knowledge generation, going more to more type of fundamental applied type of research, while having also the Horizon 2020 going more to the to the upper side of the innovation, going more to the demand type of activities, to kind of demonstration projects, to kind of market activities, public procurement, incentive prices, and all these type of this of the activities. And we consider that this it was a kind of a good a way also to avoid also complementarities. And I think this is something which, in my view, is reflects up to now well also the division of tasks between also our activities in the water programs and the water GPI. And of course, we also are committed within our activities also to support also this implementation actions of the water GPI. As you can see here, this shows the slides also the different type of supports. We have started with the coordination support action. We have also co-fund also the joint calls implemented also by the national countries. As you know, and I will come also later to that, we also promoted also the international, the role of water GPI in strengthening also the international cooperation in this area. And we have also issued a call, and I have the feeling that the results will be also communicated also very, very soon. And we plan also in the 2017 also work program to have also another ERANET co-fund action, which then will close also the overall cycle of the first water strategic agenda, addressing also together with a call that the GPI issued without the EU support, then we can also have also address also the main issues, the themes addressed in the strategic research agenda. Here we have another instrument, this initiative, this is the technology platforms. And as I said, these technology platforms had also as a primary objective also to raise also the awareness of the public sector, but also bring together the public sector together, the private sector together with the public for joint research activities. And in this context also the WSSTP also created also a strategic research agenda. Of course, again, this strategic research agenda reflects perhaps more, I would say, the industrial type of interest, but certainly I think there are still common, I think, issues, and I think it would be worthwhile. I know that there is still a strong also cooperation, but it will be also very important also to identify concrete actions to trying also to see how we can jointly also benefit for these strategic also agendas. Let me now also explain a bit about this European Innovation Partnership Initiative, and this I take also the opportunity since also our colleague the Guido Smits, which is in charge of the secretariat in charge of the European Innovation Partnership, and the colleagues of DG Environment were not able to come here, so they asked me also to incorporate these their slides also in my presentation. So try also to explain also how this, what is the European Innovation Partnership, how this works and how this can be also linked also with the water GPI. Again, the in one sense, I would say the European Innovation Partnership was mainly foreseen as a way to address also the barriers. Mainly barriers both from the technological but also for regulatory, financial type of issues, to try also to address also these barriers and also to find some ways to overcome also these barriers. And in order to do that also, they also identified some key thematic priorities which five thematic priorities which are also displayed in the slides. that where there were also these priorities where they exhibit, you know, a high level also for market uptake and creation also of new markets opportunities there. And of course, in addition to that, they also consider some horizontal activities, cross-cutting activities like water governance, decision support systems, and also financing for innovation, including also the role of digital technology, in particular smart technology, in water resources management. And of course, again, here you will recognize that many of these issues are very well also linked with the priorities of the water GPI, and also they are also reflected in WSSTP. So there, this is also a point for reflection, how better also to link these activities. So the EIP is mainly organized, I would say, through a kind of a steering, a high-level steering group. It used to meet twice per year. Now is going to meet also annually. Time to time, it used to be also supported by a task force, but to make this governance structure more flexible, this is only now ad hoc basis. But what is the main priority of, let's say, intervention is what they call action groups. And action groups are a kind of volunteer agreements between different stakeholders, you know, researchers, stakeholders, utilities, for instance, ministries, to address specific also issues and to address also the barriers which are associated to that, and trying also to translate also policy recommendations that they can also help also support the implementation of water of water-related policies. Here, what is very important are some of the key priority barriers and bottlenecks that they have also identified in their in their activities, and I would like a bit also to stay on that. I think financing is an area which has been, of course, received a lot of attention, and of course, this is an area that we all know is very, very important. But I think the issue that was also to highlight there is that there are many lacks for financing, in particular also for small and medium enterprises. And since this is an area, water, which is very fragmented, where there are many also innovative, you know, SMEs, which develop, you know, excellent products and services, there is also a need also to try also to address this issue. The other also point in this barrier is the fact that the financing is not also identified in terms of limited money. Although a lot of money is possible, it is very difficult, however, also to bring also these different activities together and to create also a kind of critical mass, to make the synergistic effect of different type of activities, either at national level, at research level, you know, regional level, and industrial level. So this is also an area that we have also to look very, very important. And of course, this is also related to the financing, with the fact also that the water is considered to be a kind of a risk aversion sector, in the sense that, of course, the stakeholders, you know, are a bit reluctant also to invest also in some innovative activities. In particular, also, you know, there are a lot of health-related issues with water, and of course, there the health risk also is predominant also in the public also. Mind. Another also important also element was also this regulatory framework. What they perceived to be as a barrier was not a kind of the lack of regulation, but the fact that very often you have not always The policies are still tend to be fragmented, and even also in the water area, although of course the Water Framework Directive trying also to act as a kind of support to build all these issues, but sometimes also there are also also some inconsistencies also with the various regulations, and also this also inconsistencies, for instance, can also hinder also this this innovation. For instance, it was also mentioned that the reuse, for instance, or recycling of water may, for instance, increase the concentration, for instance, of pollutant in wastewater, without also increasing also the total mass of pollutants discharged to the environment. But the current, for instance, implementation of the Emission Industrial Directive, for instance, does not also take sufficiently into consideration also this issue. And another also barrier was the fact that there are not easy also to have long-term demonstration sites where also people, where citizens also can see also the benefit of innovative also solutions and have also some more trust in these actions. The EAP has a kind of what they called a marketplace. So this is an area where supply and demand, but really a supply of innovative solutions are there. So you can see the figures about the products there. And in a recent also stakeholder feedback that it was done in the EAP conference, people also consider that this marketplace also is also considered also to be something positive. So the Water GPI is also dealing with the development of a kind of what they call the knowledge hub. So it is important also to reflect, to see how it is possible. Is it possible to try also to link also these issues? Because I think this is an important element where all struggle with the a lot of information is there, but it's very difficult also to find this in a very coordinated, consolidated way. So this is perhaps an area where we need also to address more. So here, as you can see, many, a lot of dissemination impacts. There are monthly newsletters. The EAP is organizing also, it's 2 years also, a conference. So this is also something to have to reflect. This is a conference where this is seems to be more addressing also the industrial type of interest. We have to see how we can eventually combine with a different type of events that, for instance, the Water GPI will also tend to have annual conferences. It will be better also to structure, to have some complementarities and avoid also duplication and trying also to cover the whole stakeholders. And here, if you are more interested in these slides, you will have also the information. Let me then finish my presentation. I still have, Patrick, a few minutes to go. Okay, saying where are you now, and what are some of the new drivers that they are going also to help us in preparing the next cycle in strategic programming. As we know, we act in preparing in 2 years work programs. We're now entering to the last programming period, which is going to address the three remaining years of the Horizon 2020. But what is also is very important is that we also consider that this will continue also feed also the reflections now and the discussions for the preparations of the following also framework program. Here, as you can see, the Commission Juncker also issued, you know, last year 10 priorities, and within these 10 priorities, here are the four main priorities where also we consider that the the Commission also, in particular the Research and Innovation Directorate also, had also a role also to play. And this is also in order also to deliver also this on Juncker's also policies, the Commission also proposed this the kind of what we call the 3O strategy. This is strategy to be open, open innovation, open sciences, and open to the world. And I think these are elements that could eventually also foster the innovation also capacity, trying also to address also the regulatory also framework, which can also help to have also innovation. As you know, there is a lot of debate to what extent also regulation can be also a driver or an impediment also for innovation. And in this context also, in particular in the context of the circular economy that I will mention, the Commission also is proposing a kind of non-legislative, more voluntary approach, what we call the innovation deals, which also this can be also an opportunity also for innovators and stakeholders also to try also to address some of the barriers which can be also real or perhaps perceived on a regulation. And this is also, the Commission also is going also to assess to what extent also these are real barriers or are just barriers which are related to the not appropriate, you know, implementation sometimes of the EU also regulation. And what is also important is, as you mentioned, in this open science and open to world, I think these two priority lines, I think, are very relevant for the water GPI, that they have to be reflected. When we talk about open science, we spoke about, you know, open results, how to share also the research results, and also very important also in related to that to search also the research data. And I think this is a very, very important area in the water, where there are plenty of databases, plenty of data needs. So these are important elements that we have also to look on, how also we have also to address and to create a kind of a way also that we benefit also for this sharing of the various also research data. Then this open to the world line, where the Commission also is willing also to tackle also the societal challenge at global level, and of course there water together also with health, energy, food are beating also these global challenges which of course have an interest. And also in this context also an important element would be also the role of science and technology also in implementing also various policies. And, you know, the role of science diplomacy is becoming very, very, very important. And we see here also water as an important element. The water diplomacy, for instance, is a term which has been also used in the recent years. And so there are a lot of potential also there. Another important also driver, as you know, is this a policy on circular economy that the Commission also proposed in last December. And here in this line of trying also to organize in such a way that we maintain and we enhance also the value of products, of resources through the whole value chain and the product life. And I think this concept can perfectly also fit water. So in particular, if we also try also to put also the different also the values chain of the water, you know, the hydrological, the environmental chain, but also the production line of the water. And I think this is also opens also a good perspective also for addressing also recovery also of resources, in particular also there are a lot of potential for nutrients, recovery of nutrients, reuse and recycling in this context. And of course, the Sustainable Development Goals is also another important, you know, policy line where the Commission also is committed also to deliver. And in the recent communication that the Commission also adopted before also the adoption of the Sustainable Development Goals last September, the role of research, science, and technology innovation is very, very important. And of course, there are dedicated also sustainable development goals and water, food, sustainable production, which all are also, of course, water-related. It's not only the water goal, but the several other goals which also are water-related. So these are important elements for the reflection. So coming to the end, so here you can see, as I said, how water has been addressed also up to now within the, as I said, in the various calls. In the beginning, water has been identified, as we said, as a kind of a focus area. In the next strategic exercise, 16-17, water was mainly mainstream within the various activities. Will be important also once this cycle also is finalized also to try also to see the to compare also the various approaches in the first programming period and the second one. But of course, certainly I think in the next programming period we would like also still water mainstream also between the different activities and pillar of the Horizon program, having also in mind that water should not be diluted there, but should also be well also reflected in these activities. And then I will have to finish my presentation stressing also this, I would say, this international cooperation in the field of water. As I said, this is water is an area which by its characteristic is a global challenge, so this is normal that there are a lot of opportunities there. I mentioned the market potential. I mentioned also the issue of transboundary river basins, so it's very important to collaborate in this context. And of course, there, the science diplomacy, as I said, plays also a very important role. And here you can see that international cooperation has already received attention in our activities. We addressed also both at the regional level and at country level. I would like also to mention also the two particular recent activities, the Piano and the Afri Alliance, which of course have a kind of more strategic nature, trying also to build also both, in particular also the Piano, it is linked with the Center for European and Water Partnership. So this is a kind of multi-governmental initiative where also has a research component. And so this Piano activity is linked to that and brings also together also the national authorities in China, both in charge of implementing also water policy, but also implementing also research activities, so that there are a lot of potentials and synergies also with the activities of the water GPI. And the Alliance project, which also Afri Alliance, trying also to put in the Africa perspective, the climate, water, and food also perspective. So these are activities which have more a kind of strategic nature more than the individual also project level cooperation. And of course, this also should be linked also with the water GPI international activities. This has been already identified as a priority and it has been also promoted by us. I think we still also believe that there are a lot of potential. GPI proven also to be also in a position also already in the ERNET co-fund calls to bring also the interest of several countries international level, and will be also important also to link on that. It was also mentioned earlier by the representative of the ministry about the Prima proposal. As you know, this is also an initiative where the Commission now is analyzing through a kind of an impact assessment the potential of intervention at the European level, and there are some of the options identified in this policy assessment. The Prima Consortium, of course, is willing to go more for a kind of an Article 185 initiative in the context of Horizon 2020. So we are going to finalize very soon this impact assessment, and on the outcome of this impact assessment, we'll be also in a position to propose a follow-up of action on that. And last but not least, I would like to mention Belmont Forum, because, as I said, that there are different types of structuring also this international cooperation. I said at country level, at the regional level, and another level is trying also to structure this international cooperation with a type of multilateral type of initiatives, and this Belmont Forum is one of these, an important multilateral activity. Is not water is not up to now, you know, very strongly also reflected in the lines of this Belmont Forum, but as you can see, there has been the recent year also some what they call this collaborative research action in this area. So there are, of course, there are potential, so there are also possibilities there. And in order also to try to find also these possibilities for synergies between different activities where are also relevant for our societal challenge five, in particular the various GPIs, water, climate, agriculture, the FATS, the urban, and also these international activities, we're also going to have very soon a workshop where also representatives of all these joint activities will also attend. And the idea is there also to reflect of possible also eventually cross-cutting activities, which may be also jointly also implemented through these activities. So I hope that this presentation, I was able also to provide you a kind of a panorama of the various drivers and activities at the European level. Here there are some links when you can also find more information, and I will also be very happy also to further interact with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Panos, and we're happy to see that the continued support of the EU. There are lots of initiatives, and we are also interested in being involved in the Prima initiative as part of the Water JPI. So thank you for that. Now, folks, you got two for the price of one there. You had Guido's contribution as well. So Panos covered both DG Research and Innovation and DG Environment. We have two speakers to go. We're still on time to make it to coffee at 11:20. I know that this is important to everybody in the room, but there is water, the water cooler over there on the corner if anybody needs it. We are, I think, medics will tell us we are 60% water. Our brain is 75% water. So if you begin to run low, your concentration certainly slips. And I wouldn't want your concentration to slip for the next speaker, Enrique Plan, who was the initial coordinator of the Water JPI. And as you well know, the most difficult thing to do is to take a concept or an idea and to put it on its feet. And that's what Enrique and Rosa and the team at Minico did in 2012 for the first 4 years. They gave birth to this baby, if you like, and they got the baby on the feet. So, Enrique, you can tell us now about the overview of the progress that you have seen.
Well, thank you, Patrick. It's a pleasure to be here among so many friends. It's been a couple of years now that I don't address the Water JPI, so I guess I'm out of shape. But I'm loving it, too. I was very happy to coordinate the Water JPI most of the days. And I was very happy to leave too, because I guess the team was exhausted. Some of them are still exhausted, my colleagues from Madrid. But and it's a pleasure to be back. But I'm very relaxed today. So as opposed to many former meetings when I was very concerned about the outcome and I was kind of tight, today I'm in the mood of being informal and trying to squeeze in a few messages that I think could benefit the initiative. Although I guess when one actually leaves the coordination of an initiative, the last thing the new coordinators require is advice, I guess. but I'm going to give it anyway. I'm always being quite outspoken. So the first problem we face is that we have no clue what joint programming meant. All this was new terminologies, new sentences, new buzzwords coming from Brussels. You know, we were discussing societal challenges before Horizon 2020, you know, because this was kind of a spin-off of the discussion of Horizon 2020. So the ministers, I remember the day I was in Mineco, and we were requested to identify societal challenges, and we had no clue what this meant. But, well, we started the discussions, the idea of water came out. There have been a number of circumstances in those days pointing at water as an interesting topic. There was an expo, there was a commitment, for instance, in Spain. But it was a difficult concept, and there was not much experience. We were actually beginning, we could build on the efforts of the ERANETs, a number of other things, but it was all very complex. The first thing which was quite surprising is that we were there in meetings like this one, gathering for an initiative animated by the European Commission, and there was no signs of money there, right? The Commission would say, no, listen, this is not for me to pay. This is for the participating countries to bring in funds. I said, oops. That was the first surprise. And in fact, that was part of the process that led to the natural selection of the partners, right? We were told, listen, you have to be very careful here, and you have to bring in the program owners, right? The national program owners of Europe, because this is about using the funds in a coordinated fashion, right? And all this was, as I said, something very novel, and we could actually succeed in identifying these programs which made us enjoy this success. But it was a lengthy process. We took a couple of years trying to establish the firm ideas that eventually led to a vision and then led to an agenda. These wonderful documents that we have received in the folders actually picture the idea very well. This is amazing documents that tell me about success, about realization, accomplishments, and about a long history, which is very well grounded now, and in an initiative which can actually have a leadership in Europe and have a very good relation to many other country efforts in the world. So I guess we stand in a very good position to continue with this impact. The dialogue with the Commission was very important. In the following years, we actually received quite a bit of support from the Commission, economic support, right? But the most important thing was the therapy. We could actually get therapy from the Commission and discuss our problems and be able to actually have a partner. That's what we had, a partner which was equally interested in our success and a partner we could rely on. But in those days, we didn't have any resources. It was very complicated to get this going because it was very hectic. We were doing many things at the same time, and we were doing miracles every day, right? Because we did not have a secretariat, a professional one. We didn't have countries which were responsible for tasks, and everything was very handmade. But it started working. And so we had to develop the vision, we had to do reports, start thinking about the SRIA, proposals, internationalization, everything was pounding on us in those days, but we could manage. And we came to Brussels very often to forge alliances, to reaffirm the partnerships in specific issues. Some visits were more successful than others, right? Sometimes we could get precisely what we needed. In other days, we were just sharing problems with the Commission, which was sometimes as puzzled as we were with the process of these initiatives, which in those days was not clear. It was an ongoing process, it was somehow an experiment, and we had to go and do this water JPI liturgy in many scientific events, and we were not yet fully believers of the idea, right? So it was a little bit complex. But then the big day came, and we came out of age. We became mature, we had the funds, we received this grant from the Commission, which was very important, and we had an inflection point, and that was 3 or 4 years ago, with the kickoff of this project, the project that we are kind of wrapping up today. And we had many things ready, and we gained visibility, and we looked like decent people there. My God, I mean, the day I saw that picture, I said, well, we probably made something, right? And we could start planning for serious funding activities, and we could actually burst out and return to society, and return to researchers and innovators, all the preparation work that we have been doing for 3 years. Everything started to work out. And we started delivering, and we went around to many places. This was in Copenhagen, and we did so in implementation of this project, which was designed to deliver, and we did, right? And we, for the first time, could decentralize the responsibilities. We started having autonomous working groups firmly established and funded in different countries. We provided specific funding to the Water JPI, and we established a community of practice and a community of learning. We started socializing with the other JPIs. We started benchmarking ourselves on the progress that other JPIs were doing. And we started a cooperation also with the GPC, and that was very fruitful because that was a forum to discuss the progress and to discuss where we stood at different times. And we have major accomplishments, but the best one is a cohesive group of research funding organizations. This was the major accomplishment. We could map what we were doing as a living document. Well, you've heard this story, the agenda, the internationalization, which is today a major success, and the communications. The major calls, we'll be hearing more about that today. A smooth transition to governance, this was extremely important. You know, after 2 years of not being around, to me, came into to this meeting as an alien now, and seeing how everything has reaffirmed the wonderful materials that the governance is doing, how it's working as a team, and how everything is not sustained but greatly improved, to me, is a matter of satisfaction. I should have left before, years before probably, because everything has now turned into decentralized headaches, and and that is always a good idea. We have many challenges ahead. Not everything in life is having fun and having dinner in Cyprus. There's more to it. There's more work to it. We need to consolidate the efforts. And at this point, I can only signal an issue which is very important, which is the contributions, the in-kind contributions that the partners are doing. You know, the Commission will never be able to pay all the effort which has brought us to this point, or the future efforts. The Commission should not pay for that. You know, this has to be an effort of the funding organizations, supported, partially funded, by the European Commission. But the personal efforts that we have been performing on behalf of our funding organizations is the critical part. Let me just give you an example. My dedication to this project as a coordinator that I was for 2 years has not been charged to the European Commission. It's all in kind. And many countries have done the same things. If we are building something which is all the interest of the countries, we need to make these funding efforts individually, the countries, in order to be able to sustain the idea and to steer it. This is an initiative which has the member states on the driver's seat in very close cooperation with the European Commission, and it needs to continue like this. Now, a critical question here is, what will bring the new framework program beyond 2020? What's going to happen? I mean, I said a couple of minutes ago that we were probably an experiment back in 2010, but probably an experiment today too, for things to come, for new arrangements, for new ways of organizing research at the European and at the global level. So I guess keeping up the good work and breaking new ground every day is an important issue for this JPI and for the rest of JPIs, because we can be setting the grounds for new funding arrangements in the future. Another message that I want to pass on, a key issue is how we squeeze in joint programming in the national programs. This is a major, I don't want to say limiting factor, but it's a major factor in our success and in our continuity. Is joint programming in general an exception in the national funding practices? Is joint programming part of the general effort of the national funding practices? How different is a JPI project from a normal national project in our funding organizations? These are critical questions in order to internationalize our science and our innovation at the country level. And this is an issue that will have to be dealt with in the years to come. It is not only the TAME joint programming initiatives, it is also initiatives like PRIMA we heard about, and many other initiatives which are actually being built on the cooperation between the national funding organizations, the European Commission, and many other international funders. And this requires some thought at the national level. And I want to come to an end of my presentation just by thanking you for your patience and by telling you how much I enjoyed the years that I served this community as a coordinator. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Enrique. We're glad you didn't leave earlier than you should have. We're glad that you stayed on and created this, and it's a testament to you and to Rosa and to Domenico that it has achieved what it has achieved to date. And that's not taking in any way from the new coordinators at ANR. Our last speaker in this section is Olka Unda. Is that correct?
Close enough.
And Olka is the Deputy Director of Land and the Water Division, Agriculture and Consumer Protection Department. I just wanted to say, anyone's phone who rings has to buy his other glass of wine at the interval. So if your phone rings, we'll send the bill to you for all the wine. Olka is the Deputy Director of the Land and Water Division of the Agriculture and Consumer Protection Department of the Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations. And I think we saw earlier from Maurice's presentation that water and food is, of course, inextricably linked. So, Olka, the floor is yours.
Good morning. I've been asked to talk about the United Nations initiatives about water and in less than 20 minutes. So I had to focus a little bit, and I thought I would talk more about the 2030 Development Agenda and the Sustainable Development Goals rather than the very many and diverse programs that are going on within the UN system. But before going to the SDGs, let me give you a few examples and ideas as to how the UN system works. Because UN is large, diverse, distributed, and sometimes difficult to understand. I've been with the UN system for almost 8 years now, a little bit over eight, and I'm still learning. But even the complexity reflects the decisions of the member states. So the substance, processes, the form that the UN as a whole and its organizations are taking are results of the decisions of the member states. So instead of obviously complaining about it, we have to comply and do the best. And in the meantime, the member states continue to assert their priorities based on changing conditions. And the SDGs is a result. The Paris Agreement is another result. And the UN system adapts to that and realigns itself or focuses depending on the changing priorities. The member states of the United Nations have not decided to have a water organization. So there is, for example, a food and agriculture organization, a scientific, educational, and cultural organization, an environmental agency, but not a water agency. For a simple reason, water crosscuts. But in order to deal with that, it has established collaborative platforms, and the current collaborative platform is called UN Water. UN Water is a coordination mechanism of the UN system with over 30 member agencies from the UN system, of FAO is one, and plus some four dozen partners coming from the global organizations, research entities, professional societies, among others. And UN Water has been tasked with coordinating the diverse work of the UN system through its several agencies and establish coherence, bring up synergies, and identify gaps and inconsistencies when they happen, and obviously remove them, deal with them. And UN Water has been working with all these 31 agencies, but probably a handful of them more substantially, depending on their mandate, and has done a very substantial job in promoting a water SDG, which is now SDG 6, during the MDG era. And when this became a possibility, then UN Water played the instrumental role of proposing a draft text for the SDG, what is SDG 6 now. When we talk about water, obviously, within the context of SDGs, SDG 6 is what we focus on, but you see the nice chart that shows all of the 17 SDGs, and water obviously flows across the SDG spectrum. So water is concentrated under SDG 6, but has impacts, implications, or is impacted by other SDGs or the actions coming from the other SDGs. FAO is involved in a good number of SDGs here on the picture, but substantially it's number two, SDG number two, which is obviously related to hunger. And then the hunger and sustainable agriculture. There is a number of SDGs where FAO is involved, and some of these have something to do with water, others have to do with poverty, land issues, soil issues, you can name it. What I would like to do is, now that we are moving into the SDG realm, and talking about the United Nations, one major difference between SDGs and MDGs is the fact that SDGs have been prepared and now are going to be implemented truly by the member states, where MDGs were more of a bureaucratic, technocratic exercise, which was then taken to the member states, which approved them after some modifications. But the SDG process is totally bottom-up, member state-driven, and the way now it's moving, the indicators for targets are being defined, and some of them are being tested in the field, and this is also very much member state-driven. SDG 6 is also an improvement over the MDG suite of goals, international goals, in that MDGs actually lacked a water goal for number one. And number two, irrespective of having a specific water goal, MDGs did not actually address the broad spectrum of water other than the relatively narrow sub-area of drinking water, safe drinking water, and adequate sanitation. Then water existed implicitly, less directly in some other SDGs, including MDGs, including environmental sustainability. But the integrity of the water resources spectrum was not present. Here we have the full spectrum, and obviously as the international water community, we take some pride in promoting the necessity to have an integrated and unifying goal in the current international philosophy towards sustainable development when it comes to water. I'm not going to go into the nitty-gritties of the SDG 6, but SDG 6 obviously addresses safe drinking water and sanitation, water quality and wastewater, water-related ecosystems, integrated water resources management, and water efficiency. Then the extremes of water is taken care of elsewhere, but it's included in this suite. Out of this, there is a distribution at the UN system level as to who will support what SDG, what targets, and how the indicators will be populated and how the data will be obtained and processed. And obviously, this has to be done by the member states, and the UN system is given the task of assisting the member states in whatever of these different steps is applicable at the specific level, national, regional, and global. Then the UN has the responsibility, the overall responsibility of turning the national inputs and data into regional and global assessments and indicators, and within which this is the UN system that is taking a role. By the way, these are also the members of UN Water, which I talked about. And just a small analogy, when the former coordinator of GPI was talking about the evolution of GPI, UN Water was pretty much created the same way. Okay, we are providing a platform to you, bringing you together, but we can't give you any money. So you raise your own funds, and if you don't raise your own funds, still, this is a good platform. You talk and synergize, close the gaps, and then provide value added. But now it has evolved, and it has earmarked funds to deal with issues that involve multiple mandates of their member agencies. Within this mandate, coming to the more specific now, within the next 5-6 minutes, the SDG 6 is addressed at the UN level by UN Water, which is very normal. And within UN Water, there is a subgroup that is dealing specifically with the targets and the indicators under these targets. And through an initiative that we called JEMI, which is the abbreviation of something that doesn't exist anymore, but we kept the abbreviation. This is the integrated monitoring of water and sanitation and water, the full spectrum. UN Water has been able to raise enough funds, primarily from the Swiss government and some from Germany, in order to do the methodological work and ways to populate the indicators and then do a proof of concept phase with selected number of countries. These are the lead agencies for the indicators under the SDG 6 goal, and FAO has been tasked with the target that relates to efficiency and stress. For obvious reasons, we are, as the food and agriculture sector, as the user of global water resources at a rate of 70% or more, and we have a vested interest to make it more efficiently used and also to deal with scarcity issues and water stress. The indicators under target 6.4 are two. One is the percentage change in efficiency, water use efficiency over time, and the second indicator is the level of water stress, which is defined as the percentage freshwater withdrawals in terms of the total available freshwater resources. And as I indicated, this is on national scale. Then it's the responsibility of the agency, which is FAO in this particular case, to come up with regional and global indicators for the same, and also help the member states with these indicators to populate them. And for this, FAO has established a special team and also has, as I said at the very beginning, was able to realign some of the existing programs, such as its water scarcity expertise and the only global data and information base AquaStat that it operates in order to serve the SDG 6 as its number crunching machinery behind its targets. In addition to this, the work of FAO obviously covers the large spectrum of sustainable food and agriculture. And sustainability indicates that we are not only looking into producing the 60% more food needed by 2050, but doing it sustainably by preserving the integrity of the ecosystems and the natural resource base. This is a random selection of some of the FAO programs, more centered here at the headquarters in Rome, and then disseminated to the countries for which they are relevant through some 170 projects and programs that FAO is involved in through its country, sub-regional, and regional offices. And these programs include drought risk management, groundwater management, water tenure, the monitoring of soil and water quality, water for rural poor, management of irrigation systems with an emphasis on modernization and rehabilitation, and work around the nexus, including solar-powered irrigation. And with this, Mr. Chair, I end my presentation. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you. Okay. The Sustainable Development Goal at the United Nations, I suppose, is at the higher level, but it demonstrates that water and water issues are very, very important globally, and water knows no boundaries. Now, we're just a few minutes over time. We will break for 15, 20 minutes. I will clap my hands vigorously when I want to get you all back in the room. So I want you to go reasonably quickly now to have your coffee, top up, a bathroom break, and we will try to be back here in about 15, 20 minutes. Thank you very much.